Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Ken Ruscio, the president of W&L, and in just a minute, I'm going to turn it over to Bob Strong for a more formal introduction of our guests this evening. But I wanted to take a minute to set the context, the broader context of the program and the reason why Taylor Branch is joining us. Bob will give a more formal introduction, but I do want to take 1 minute to welcome Taylor Branch back to campus. Some of you were around back, and I can't remember exactly when. It was sometime in the 90s when Taylor Branch visited here. And something happened during that trip that has caused the Ruscio family to have not only respect for him, but a certain fondness for him. My son was in the third grade at that time, and Taylor, I'm sure, doesn't remember this, but my son was in the third grade at the time, and the class project was to pick a historical figure and write a report on that figure and present that report orally to the class. My son picked Martin Luther King, and right around that time, Taylor Branch was visiting campus, and my son scheduled an interview with Martin Luther King's biographer. The quality of the third grade footnotes were unusually high in that report. But we've always been grateful for that moment and his generosity of time to sit with the third grader and talk to him about Martin Luther King. I will turn it over to Bob in just a minute, but I did want to again say a little bit about the broader context in which this is occurring. About a year and a half ago, the Mellon Foundation wrote to me and said, if you have an idea to start a campus conversation and to engage faculty and students around a particular topic, we're willing to give you, President Ruscio, some funds to do that. So do you think you could come up with an idea in 3 weeks? And I said, I think I could. That's sort of my job in some ways, not to turn down money. And so and if you recall, about a year and a half ago, you can understand why I thought that history in the public sphere might be a good topic for us to explore here at Washington and Lee. It had occurred to me in some of the controversies that we were dealing with that history is complex, and the complexity of history is something worth pondering and studying. But some of the conversations around that time had the characteristic of history is simplification, and if we can just reduce this very complex thing to some very, very simple things, we can find the answer. So history in the public sphere and the appropriate and inappropriate use of history to help us understand contemporary problems was a topic that I thought this university ought to be engaged in. Because if any institution, and the Mellon Foundation agreed with us on this, if any institution ought to be able to deal with the complexity of history, it should be this institution, since the arc of our own institution's history traces so carefully the arc of our nation's history, from the time of the founding, through the time of the Civil War, through the time of the Civil Rights, and on up into today. So with that, we embarked upon a year and a half, really 2 year project of engaging that topic of history in the public sphere and looking at it in a variety of ways and inviting such distinguished people as Taylor Branch to campus to help us understand that. So with that, let me turn it over to Bob Strong to introduce our guest this evening. Bob.
Our guest, I think, is known to many of you. He's had a distinguished career as a journalist, an author, a research scholar, a biographer. You are quite likely to know him from the prize-winning volumes that make up his books, America in the King Years. There is, by the way, a book signing at the conclusion of our event this afternoon. You may not know that he's currently working with HBO to take a portion of that biographical material to be converted into a soon-to-be-available HBO production. In 2009, he published a book called The Clinton Tapes, Wrestling History with the President, that was the subject of a seminar he gave this afternoon with a group of students that are studying the Clinton presidency. It was a fascinating conversation. The book is based on a series of oral history interviews he did with the president while the president was still in office, capturing his immediate memories and responses to the events in that turbulent period. There are lots of pieces of journalism I could mention, but many of you may know the cover story from the Atlantic Monthly a few years ago titled "The Shame of College Sports," which attracted a great deal of attention. He's returning to that subject in a piece he's prepared for this weekend's New York Times. NPR commentator Frank DeFord said, Branch's article may well be the most important one ever written about college sports. He's a thorough researcher. He's a graceful writer. And we're very, very pleased to have him with us. Let me just mention one piece of biography you're unlikely to know. His high school rock and roll band is still performing. The Beatles broke up, but his group did not. And today, they have released their third collection of music. You can't call them albums anymore, but their third release took place today. His group now uses the age-appropriate name. They call themselves Off Our Rockers. I could read lots of honors and awards he's won. There are many. Let me just mention one of them. Last week, the National Archives Foundation honored Taylor Branch with their Records of Achievement Award. This is a prize they have previously given to Ken Burns, to David McCullough, to Steven Spielberg. It's a major annual award that goes to an author or artist who works in archives and tells stories from the American past that are accessible to audiences all across the country and all around the world. It was an appropriate choice this year that Taylor Branch received that honor. In preparation for today's event, he gave us two versions of a title to use on our posters. One, he said, was the bland, straightforward version. The other was a bit more jazzed up. That's the one we used. Scalawags and Big Government, How Racial History Warps Politics. Please join me in welcoming to Washington and Lee, Taylor Branch.
Thank you, Bob. Yes, we did take the more risque title. I don't use it very often. The idea is that for a grant like this to engage in the role of history in American politics, that you want something that puts a little more grit in your oyster so we can try to address the controversy, and that's what I really hope to do. But first, I want to thank President Ruscio and Mrs. Ruscio, really, for not only welcoming me into their home, but entrusting me with their third grader years ago. I trust that he's doing well, and we'll catch up later. But I'm glad to be back at WNL. I'm gonna try to engage with you before questions some provocative thoughts on the full range of American history, growing out of my specialty as someone who has written mostly about the role of race in our history. It was not a role that I was born for. I was born in Atlanta, the son of a dry cleaner who hated politics and said that people interested in politics couldn't find honest work. I never planned to be a writer or to be interested in race relations at all. But it happened that the civil rights movement grew up all around me in my formative years. I was in the first grade the year of the Brown decision. I started high school the year of the Freedom Rides. I finished high school the year of Freedom Summer. And I finished college in the spring when Dr. King was killed. So for my whole formative years, the movement was percolating. It was unavoidable. Everybody was afraid of it, black and white, by and large. Many people say they were in the middle of it, and most of them are lying. It was scary, but it had such power that it changed the direction of my life's interest against my will. And I've been enthralled to study the role of race in American history ever since. Before we start out, I want to address the students. I know there are a lot of non-students and older people that I'm confident can answer these questions, but I want to just start with four extreme basics. How many of you know what a scalawag is? Any of the young people know what a scalawag is? How many of you know, if you don't know what a scalawag is, do you think it's pejorative or a praiseworthy term? It's a pejorative term that is part of our vocabulary for a white person in the aftermath of the Civil War who believed in the 14th and 15th Amendments, that is the right of freed people to slave and to vote and to have due process under the 14th Amendment. Second question, we'll save this for later. How many of you can recite the first sentence to the U.S. Constitution? Anybody? The preamble. One, all right, I may call on you. Third question, how many of you know, particularly you young people, how many of you know who George Wallace is? Any young people? Everybody knows who George Wallace is, right? He's the governor of Alabama, who famously took his inaugural speech and said, segregation today, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. And he was the governor during the opposing sneering governor at the height of the civil rights era. And finally, I won't ask you if you have seen Confederate memorials, because we're basically standing in one, and I saw stuff I saw stuff all around Lexington when I drove in about it. But I do want to ask, how many people have ever seen a memorial or a marker for a lynching? I'd be surprised if anyone did, because so far I've only found one in the United States, and it's in Louisiana. And the supreme irony is that it was put up by the citizens of Colfax, Louisiana, not in atonement for the lynching, which killed 160 black people in destroying the free government then and restoring white supremacy in 1875. But the memorial is for three white people who were killed while they were doing it. So the only lynching memorial in the United States that's been erected so far memorializes the lynchers. It's just a notion, a beginning notion of the importance of race, but not just what happens with race, but how we process our memories of it. And that we've been doing it throughout our history, and that it has profound effects on our politics. Now, in the constitutional era, the very beginning, many of the key compromises at the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia involved race and slavery, particularly slavery. But of course, the word slavery is never mentioned. In the Three-Fifths Clause, which really was, Alexander Hamilton said, without that, there would have been no Constitution, which gave the Southern states representation in Congress for three-fifths of slaves who were considered otherwise property and couldn't vote, but it allowed the slave-holding states extra representation to represent their slaves, which buttressed their power. It's one of the extra reasons that there were so many Southern presidents in the early portion of the United States, and the Congress was inflated or deflated, because the Southern position was that they wanted to have full representation for slaves as people, even though they couldn't vote. But there were many others over fugitive slaves. It's in the Constitution, most centrally in the Three-Fifths Clause, but it is nowhere mentioned, which is a clue that from the very beginning, we've been skittish and we've used euphemisms about it to conceal how central it is in a lot of our underlying politics and how we even define politics. Now, the Constitutional Convention and the Constitution that was argued and ratified, the ratifying convention here in Virginia is one of the central events. It was very, very close. Virginia was divided just like this, whether or not this Constitution was salvation for the hopes of free people or overbearing tyranny. And this is not the place to go into that, but it's a wonderful conversation. I want to just raise two things that came out of it, also from Virginia, another Virginian, Madison, by and large the father of the Constitution there. In the Federalist Papers arguing for the ratification of the Constitution, he boiled down the premise of free government. In effect, the psychological basis for the American experiment, we still call it an American experiment, with good reason. I mean, most people who have ever drawn breath, including many millions, hundreds of millions still alive today, laugh at the notion that people can govern themselves. Before that, even into the 100 years ago, in 1915, the world was canopied with dictators and sultans and kings and emperors. Very, very few Democrats. The notion, in Republican government, free government, based in the people, based in we the people, that first sentence we're getting back to. Madison, people thought it was preposterous that you could set up a Republican form of government based on votes rather than loyalty and force. Something hierarchical, that you could set up something that's basically three co-equal branches of government. The whole design of it is horizontal, relating people to one another through the government. In government, we the people. Madison said there are two propositions in it that we turn the world upside down. One is that we believe people can govern themselves instead of having some superior force govern them. He said, respect for truth animates every votary of freedom to rest all our political experiments on the capacity of mankind for self-government. We're still doing that. We call this self-government. The other one that complements, and it's just as important, is that he said, without virtue in the people, no form of government can secure liberty in the people. That public trust, that building public trust among one another, is a linchpin co-equal with believing that we can be individually and collectively self-governing together. That's the American experiment, that we can be self-governing together and that we can build public trust in one another against all the people that laugh at those notions, because the psychology of all previous government and much surviving government is exactly the opposite. The people in government trust themselves and they discipline other people. We say we can govern ourselves and we build trust in other people. That's the psychological basis. Now, flash forward to 1961, when I'm starting high school and the Freedom Riders take off out of Virginia, through Virginia, to ride through the South, testing the proposition that busloads of people can survive a ride through the South sitting black and white in the same bus without being killed. That was the climate of the day. The main bus, the first bus, got all the way to Anniston, Alabama before it was ambushed and burned. The other bus did get into Birmingham, but every single person in there was sent to the hospital in a beating in the bus station. Before the end of the Freedom Rides, the whole world was watching headlines over whether the government of the United States, based in self-government and public trust, could literally move a bus out of the Birmingham bus station with black and white people in the same bus. What I want to draw your attention to is the psychology of the movement people who were in that bus. They were there in training, having been trained, black and white, in the belief that they were willing to die but not to kill for the principles in the American Constitution, and that if, as they were, they were confronted by people hostile to them because of the fact that they were traveling interracially, they would look them in the eye and they were trained to say, you may beat me, but I believe that my witness here will build trust one day, if not between us, between our children and grandchildren. I'm offering that to you out of the heart of the civil rights movement as a quintessential model of the psychology of faith in democratic government. who could be more self-governing than somebody looking a Klansman with a chain in the eye and saying, you can hit me, and also making human contact with that person in spite of their hostility to say, you and I are in this together and we're building a government of self-government and public trust. They didn't get out the whole speech, but I'm just saying that was the attitude. That's what they were trained to do, and they went through with that. And when the bus was burned in Anniston, there was a bunch of teenagers at Fisk University in Nashville who had been training in nonviolence and had been doing sit-ins. And they were having a Mother's Day picnic because it was on Mother's Day that the bus was burned and the Trailway bus was beaten. And one of the young ladies named Diane Nash, who's some actress is going to get famous playing her if we get our miniseries going, Diane Nash ruined the Mother's Day picnic because she saw the news of what had happened down in Birmingham, and she says, we have to go to Birmingham. And her friends were flabbergasted. They said, what are you talking about? We're in Tennessee. We've got all we can say grace over. We've just gone through a 40-day campaign trying to integrate the movie theaters, which were segregated then. And she says, I know, but if violence can stop the movement, can stop those people, and they leave, which they were doing, then the movement is dead because it will send a signal that violence is stronger than the movement. And she ruined their picnic, basically telling them, okay, go ahead and have your potato chips, but the world is falling apart and this is up to us. This was one of many ideas that Diane had that enlarged the conception of what a movement was, of what its responsibility was. And she literally badgered these people into going down and getting into the same bus from which the people were beaten and continuing the Freedom Rides. And by the end of 1961, there were 600 Freedom Riders who had come from all over the country and went into Parchman Penitentiary in Mississippi to continue that ride and prove that nonviolence would not flinch in the face of hostility, but it would maintain this witness. And that was the ethos of the movement. I will tell you quickly, just Diane Nash not only enlarged the Freedom Rides, the movement in the Freedom Rides, taking the movement, which is seldom thought about. A movement is something that starts with a small inspiration, a prayer. When you're moved by something, you feel some connection with something larger than yourself. And it can grow through risk, like going in a demonstration, like going in a sit-in. You can discover common cause with people that makes you and your cause feel larger, until finally, if it grows large enough, it's a movement that can affect history. Diane was part of many of those. It was her idea when Dr. King's movement was failing in Birmingham in 1963. He went there to go for broke, but he was about to leave because nothing good had happened and the adults in Birmingham were about to run him out of town, when she said, you can take children. We've been training children. They want to participate. We're asking them, are you slaves? If not, why can't your parents go downtown? Why can't you go downtown? And in the supreme, people thought they were nuts. I mean, literally nuts, to use small children as soldiers in a nonviolent army. But that's one advantage of a nonviolent army over a regular army. Rather than retreat on May 2nd, 1963, Dr. King sent 1,000 small children to march in Birmingham. The previous day, they had been able to muster only 12 adults to march downtown because horrible things were happening in the Birmingham jail. So they used children, and the next day, May 3rd, they sent another 1,000, and by then the jails were full, and the Birmingham police had felt that they had no alternative but to loose dogs and fire hoses on those children. And those photographs went all around the world of the small children, mostly girls, as young as 6 years old, persevering through dogs and fire hoses, singing Sunday school songs. It broke down people's emotional resistance to say, yes, segregation is bad, but the president should deal with it or somebody else should deal with it. It broke down people's emotional barriers so that they said, I should do something about it. We should all do something about it. And it was a tremendous emotional breakthrough. But a telling point I want to make to you from that in relation to the Constitution and its euphemisms for slavery is that to this day there has never been a scholarly analysis of the political effect of the children's marches on May 2nd and May 3rd. It had such a transformative emotional effect, but it's my theory is that it's basically embarrassing for political scientists to say this is what turned the fulcrum of involvement over segregation. I argue that it's unmistakably true because within 6 weeks of May 3rd, there were demonstrations going on in 700 cities. It spread like wildfire, and President Kennedy had a speech, basically you can hear the tapes, saying we can't put these out one at a time, we've got to deal with the whole thing, and he went on television and proposed the Civil Rights Act. And Dr. King said, we're on a breakthrough, we need a national protest, let's have a march on Washington. So Diane Nash was a catalyst for the Freedom Rides, a catalyst again for Dr. King's greatest risk in his entire career. And then in the fall of 1963, when the Birmingham church was bombed on September 15th, just 18 days after the March on Washington, Diane felt a tremendous responsibility. Not that the kids that were killed were marchers, in fact they weren't, but they were killed, the church that was bombed was the church that all the children marched out of. It was the movement church. And she felt responsible because she had been so instrumental in getting children to be involved, and now here are four of them killed, that she and her husband stayed up all night on the night of the church bombing and said, it is up to us to devise a plan to answer this heinous crime. And by then they were so upset that they said, essentially, a lot of people are giving up on nonviolence. We could have a Malcolm X vigilante response. We know who did the bombing. Everybody, the bombers were well known in Birmingham. We'll get vigilantes and go down there and have vigilante justice against them. But by morning, they thought better of that. They said, we know nonviolence, and they devised a nonviolent plan to paralyze the state of Alabama nonviolently in demonstrations until it granted black people in Alabama the right to vote, which became the blueprint for Selma. Basically, what I'm telling you is that Selma was Diane Nash's idea. It wasn't Dr. King's idea. She got on him. Her husband, if you've seen the film, The African Queen, her husband and several friends say that she got on Dr. King about her plan the way the leeches got on Humphrey Bogart when he was down in the river, and said that you have to do this. And that's where Selma comes from. Now, Selma's been in the news as a culmination of the movement. Now, let me shift. I want to shift to George Wallace. I ask you if you know who George Wallace is. By 1964, when the Civil Rights Act is introduced, Dr. King, in fact, it was right at the end of 63, at the very beginning of 64, right after the Kennedy assassination, when the Civil Rights Movement is still cresting, he gave a very interesting small speech in which he said, I want to talk with you about something today that's happening. He said, I'm afraid that Wallaceism is bigger than Wallace. I want to explain to you what he meant by that. Or he said, I want to explain to you what I mean by that. So I'm paraphrasing his speech. He said, George Wallace has completely retooled his standard stump speech because he wants to run for president this year. And he has turned his standard stump speech into minor little classics. And he quoted the Wallace speech. He said, first of all, he has eliminated all mention of segregation and all mention of race. He never mentions it. And in fact, his standard line is, if you want to talk about race, it's favoritism. So I don't want to talk about race. George Wallace said, in fact, he insisted that he had never denigrated a person in his entire public life on the basis of their race, which is almost laughable because that's what he was synonymous for. But he knew that if he said it, people in the long run would adapt to it. and they're not going to stand up and challenge it. So he got away. He said, I do not have a racist bone in my body. Here's what my new plan is. This is his stump speech. My only interest is campaigning against pointy-headed bureaucrats at the central government in Washington, tyrannical judges, and legislators who are high on their own power. Pointy-headed, he coined all these phrases. He says, my only interest is the restoration of local government from tyrannical government in Washington. And he got together with Ross Barnett, the governor of Mississippi, and they went on NBC in the fall of 1963, and they said, this whole race issue, which we will not talk about anymore, is the result of a media conspiracy to overemphasize the race issue in collaboration with politicians whose ultimate goal is the concentration of all effective power in Washington. They invented the vocabulary of modern politics. The dominant idea in the last 50 years has been that government is bad. What I want to tell you is that this is not new. This is a reaction to the centrality of race in defining our politics. It's always been there from the very beginning. At the end of the Civil War, we passed three constitutional amendments, one to end slavery, one to establish due process, and citizenship expressly for the new freed people who were the citizens. It was a constitutional amendment designed to guarantee that people were treated, had equal treatment, due process of law. And then the 15th Amendment on the right to vote. Within 20 years, both the 14th and 15th Amendment were dead letters already. And I grew up being told that they didn't have really any application. In fact, before the end of the 19th century, the 14th Amendment, and I hope maybe there's some legal people here, the 14th Amendment was stripped of all application for what it was expressly written for, which is the guaranteeing the rights of the freedmen, and it was applied instead to the rights of corporations who were upset that they were subject to different regulations in different states, and they wanted a constitutional assurance from the federal government that they would have equal protection of the laws in all the states. So the corporations wound up getting what was designed for the slaves, the ex-slaves, and the freedmen were reduced back into near peonage. And denied the right to vote very quickly, and it became a non-issue. The 15th Amendment was gone. 50 years afterwards, in 1913, Woodrow Wilson went to Gettysburg, freshly the first Southern president, and gave the 50-year, half-century address after Lincoln's Gettysburg address, in which he said, It is pernicious and wrong to inquire after what the Battle of Gettysburg signified, who won, and why. We are only here to celebrate the valorous people on both sides who looked at each other in the eye and are now smiling. No black soldiers were part of that celebration. And Woodrow Wilson segregated the federal government in Washington within 12 days of that speech in Gettysburg. But the important thing is not that, it's the attitude with which it was done. A delegation of black citizens went to see Woodrow Wilson to protest the fact that this was the first application of segregation within the federal government. And he said, segregation, sirs, is a benefit, not a humiliation, because people would do worse to you. And you ought to view it in that regard. We whitewashed the history of the aftermath of slavery to the point that all we have are cuss words for scalawags and carpetbaggers. And in fact, I hope it's not true here at WNL, but in many history books, the process by which black people were driven out of the ballot box was classified in my textbooks and still in many textbooks as redemption. That is the quote. It gave a religious label in history books to a process of terror by the Klan that drove black people out of politics and restored white supremacy. But we adjusted our memory so that we didn't notice that the Confederate memorials are going up everywhere in a sense of virtue, and that's fine. But lynchings were going on at the same time and no memorial for them. How do we remember one but not the other? When I was growing up in Atlanta, I thought nothing of it until years later that my history book said the Civil War had almost nothing to do with slavery. It was about different constitutional theories of federalism, and that slaves were better off here as slaves than they had been in Africa. That was in textbooks. And it's not that long ago, and our memories do change. What I want to argue to you is that history goes in 50-year cycles often, and that we have done since 1965 something of what we did from 1865 to 1915. We've done from 1965 to 2015 in the sense of misremembering a pinnacle period of American life. When the Selma marchers, Diane Nash was there, when they marched over Pettus Bridge, I know a lot of you have seen the film, it was 600 black folks, no white people in this demonstration, in the first one. They were beaten, it was a nonviolent march, they were beaten, and 9 days later, Lyndon Johnson went before the Congress. The movie, and a lot of people call it the We Shall Overcome speech, because he said, we shall overcome, he proposed the Voting Rights Act. But that's not what was really significant. If you ever get a chance to read that speech, you can read the whole thing, I encourage you to do it, but just read the first four paragraphs or so. I speak tonight for the dignity of man and the destiny of democracy. Two paragraphs later, he said, there are certain times when fate and destiny come together at a single place, at a single point in time, to mark a turning point in man's unending search for freedom. So it was at Lexington and Concord. So it was a century ago at Appomattox. And so it was last week in Selma. And he went on from there. Already what he has done is to take those Selma marchers and put them at the forefront of iconic American patriotism alongside white soldiers from the founding of the American Republic and the greatest crisis of the American Republic, saying that they are visionary leaders in calling us to the true meaning of we the people. This is an extraordinary speech, and it is pregnant. You could teach courses on it forever because there are two obvious differences. One, the soldiers at Lexington and Concord and at Appomattox were overwhelmingly white. We're comfortable to think of them as our leaders, as our heartfelt. We're grateful to them. The ones at Selma were all black, and they were nonviolent, they weren't soldiers. Or they were soldiers, but they were soldiers in a nonviolent army whose entire credo, according to Dr. King, was that in an interdependent world, lasting power grows against the grain of violence, not with it. And that's why America is the hope of the world. Because what is the design? What is the design of our American experiment in we the people? It's to make votes the linchpin of power. That's what we believe in. We believe in votes. And what is a vote? A vote is a little piece of nonviolence that we empower by the public trust and the self-government that we build up over time. Dr. King used to always give these speeches saying, look, people think nonviolence is for Indian vegetarians and other exotic people. If you believe in democracy, you believe in nonviolence because the whole architecture of democracy is a cathedral of votes, and every vote is nothing but nonviolence. not just in the Congress and not just on the Supreme Court when they settle decisions by votes, but at this university and in your little league team and everything else. We're massively surrounded by votes that organize our commerce and the invisible ties of power that we have. And Dr. King said, always through the whole movement, we grow against the grain of violence. The Southerners tried to defend segregation with violence, and look what happened. The world rose up against it. And he also would say continuously that it's an axiom of nonviolent action in democracy that when any group struggles properly and justly to achieve its own rights, it enlarges the rights of all. This element is what makes both democracy and nonviolent action self-renewing and creating. Again, in 65, 50 years ago, he said, the stirring lesson of this age is that mass nonviolent direct action is not a peculiar device for Negro agitation. Rather, it is an historically validated method for defending freedom and democracy and for enlarging these values for the benefit of the whole society. My mayor in Atlanta, Ivan Allen, where I grew up, told me that on the day the Civil Rights Bill passed in 1964, he went before the city council, proposed to build a sports stadium on land Atlanta didn't yet own with money it hadn't raised for a sports team that it had not located. But within 10 months, they lured the Milwaukee Braves to become the Atlanta Braves and the first professional sports team in the South, because when the stigma of segregation was removed, the South was open for the benefit of all. Danny Thomas founded the Miami Dolphins not long after that, when there was no longer any segregation by federal law. The South opened up. Everybody who has a daughter, everybody who values being able to sit in a room like this, where we have people of different races and our palms are not sweaty for fear that people will lose their jobs or that the Klan will show up, stands on the shoulders of a black-led movement that was the leaders of democracy in that time, recognized by the President of the United States. But within a few months of Lyndon Johnson's speech, that notion, the reaction set in against it, just as it set in against the 14th and 15th Amendments 100 years before. Not just in white society, in which by the end of that year, instead of saying that black people had provided leadership to address problems that were paralyzing the whole country and that we should study those methods for what they were doing, by the end of that year, people rallied around the notion that the black family and black poverty was the problem and that we, the white experts, are still the doctors. That idea to soothe people that this is not a leadership phenomenon that we're seeing rose up. But it also, the movement split apart. Black power supplanted nonviolence. Nonviolence became passé, probably the most powerful idea in the whole course of the movement. And we begin to misremember the significance of nonviolence, the significance of black leadership, the significance of having self-government and nonviolent witness to advance democracy, and that votes are the keys to it that tie us together. And we began to forget all of that and think essentially it's our guns that keep us safe when we go into Starbucks, not the ties between us. And the reaction set in within the movement, the black power movement, and everywhere else. And we have misremembered the history. And what a 50 years we have misremembered. The civil rights movement set in motion things for women, for senior citizens, for disabled people, for gay people. When you begin that model for struggling over what equal citizenship really means and what lessons it means for reaching out to people who are different and trying to understand those differences and transcend them, the civil rights movement let loose the greatest collateral waves of freedom in our history. Think about it. I mean, I think about it as a writer. My first few books were written on legal pads because they hadn't figured out how to make electric typewriters. Then I got some electric typewriters. So this is big history. But in that time, the Supreme Court in Hoyt v. Florida upheld a Florida statute that said women could serve on juries in spite of state laws to the contrary in many places. But in order to do that, they had to go down to the courthouse and sign a petition asking to be considered to serve on jury service and affirming that it would not interfere with their homemaking duties. This is a different world. The want ads were separated. Not only help wanted white and help wanted black, but help wanted male, help wanted female. Women were not permitted not just to be members of the National Press Club in Washington, but even to enter the building. So it was segregated by race and by gender. The idea of gay rights, you know, it was all criminal, and so was intermarriage. And so many individual ripples of freedom are taken for granted or overlooked today. I mean, we just celebrated the 50th anniversary of the Immigration Act of 1965, in which Lyndon Johnson, when he pushed through the Voting Rights Act, he said, "By God, where's my immigration bill?" Because until that time, the only legal immigrants who were allowed to come and become nationalized citizens were restricted to the countries of extremely northern Europe, unless they were Cuban refugees, by special invitation. The rest of the world was blacked out by the Nationalities Act of 1964. And Johnson, in the wake of the Voting Rights Act, said, where is it? I've got to get it through. And in September, a month after the Voting Rights Act, he pushed through this and signed it under the Statue of Liberty in Washington and said, this preference, the quota preference system that has restricted the notion of American citizenship to the northern realms of Europe is repealed, and henceforth no foreigner will be too foreign to become a fellow citizen. And never again will the gate to this nation be shadowed by the twin barriers of prejudice and privilege. And it has opened up, it's changed the face of the United States literally and figuratively. I don't know how many international students you have here. I know you have a lot of female students, but you didn't have either one in 1965. I went to Carolina. It was my Carolina band, not my high school band, but the Carolina band. And back then, W&L was famous. Everybody said it was a place that you could go to hang by your knees from the plumbing pipes in the basement of the fraternity house. It didn't have the resonant intellectual image then that it has now, thanks in part to women and a lot of other civilizing influences for which we all thank you. So what I'm saying is that we are unconscious of the many, many blessings that have flowed from the risks that those nonviolent activists like Diane Nash took to rescue the promise of American citizenship, even when they were denied the benefits of it. They studied it. They knew it. I asked Diane Nash once about a document in which the FBI was harassing her family, and she dismissed it. She said, "That's just Hoover." And I said, "What do you mean it's just Hoover? This is a horrible thing they did to you." And she said, "Look, we're studying American citizenship, and the first thing they tell you is that if you give arbitrary power in secret over 50 years to the same person, you're going to get exactly what you got with J. Edgar Hoover, so that's our fault, not his." There was a tremendous breadth, as well as courage, to the commitment, in the commitment of black leadership to nonviolence then. And I hate to see it wasted, even if unconsciously, by the fact that we have drifted along into another period of calling a period of scalawags and modern carpetbaggers. We're in an era of gridlock, but no one examines what the underpinnings of gridlock are. It's just take it for granted. If it's gridlock, where did it come from? How do we get rid of it? We're in a cynical era. Well, how did that happen? How do we get rid of it? The movement people would have challenged it, they would have analyzed it, they would have figured out how to challenge it. But we just drift along. And that's why I think that to recapture our own patriotism and the lessons that are right there, the liberation, the capacity that if those people felt that they could tackle the most intractable problems in the country in an era of segregation, when people, Dr. King went to a funeral for somebody executed over stealing $2.65, when black people couldn't vote, if those people could face and muster the common will to be optimistic about our most intractable problems, what's our excuse? And how can we drift along in an era of gridlock without asking why? And the grit I'm trying to put in your oyster is not that race is all of politics, but that it's not separate from politics. It's not something where, oh gosh, we want to suspend our politics so we can have a conversation about race. If your conversation about politics doesn't include race as a central barometer of democratic purpose, then it's not real. And it's in danger of misappropriating more scalawags and losing and more redeemers and all that sort of thing that betray our own promise. And that's why I say it's one of the first things I really noticed in studying the movement was that at movement meetings, people would recite the preamble to the Constitution at the beginning. I always used to wonder about that. Why would they do that? But now I think every political person should do that. Because the preamble of the Constitution, written not by a slaveholder, Gouverneur Morris wrote it, but it was the committee was slaveholders, writing this Constitution for people that is visionary in this system, great system of votes. But the one sentence in the preamble is a mixture of incredible audacity. The list of things they say they're going to do in this government of we the people, and how it becomes we the people is votes, which means not violence, so different from traditional power by the sword. But we're going to do all of these things. It requires tremendous faith, but also audacity and optimism about the capacity of this government. We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. That's not the spirit of our politics today. It was the leadership spirit of the civil rights movement. And I think we would all do well to take a black-led movement as the model for how to advance a democracy that was initiated by slaveholders. That's a great paradox of American history. But I think if we want to make our history an instrument of political health, look at race, recapture that faith. Because to me, as a white Southerner who spent most of my life studying the movement, what I come away with is gratitude that a people denied the benefits of democracy had the grace and the capacity and the political genius and the courage to lift the rest of us toward our own professed values. Thank you.
We have time for some questions. Not too much time, but time for some questions. But I am going to ask, if you'd like to ask a question, please come to the front of either aisle and use the microphone so that everyone can hear it and so that it can be properly recorded on the streaming that's being done for this event. Is there anyone who wants
Thank
to
you.
Come forward?
Doesn't have to be about these highfalutin ideas. Yes, sir.
Thank you for that amazing talk. Can you just say now, what would you want Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump or Marco Rubio or the other leaders of this country right now seeking the presidency to do as a result of your wonderful analysis of this problem of race?
recite the preamble to begin every speech, say that we need to recapture the optimism at the heart of our purpose, to recognize that it is through votes and coming together that we can tackle intractable problems, and then lay out what the intractable problems are. Because I'm not saying that they're all grounded in race. We have problems of displacement in our, global displacement in our economy and the environmental crises and all kind of economic crises and everything. All I'm saying is that if our politics is still to some degree paralyzed by, I argue that the underpinnings, if you look at the George Wallace stuff, ever since George Wallace, big government, that was transmuting. It was making racial hostility respectable as long as it was directed at cussing the government. We need to get out of that. Unfortunately, I think, I don't want to get into partisan politics too much, but I think a lot of the Republican problem is that they're trapped because being hostile to government is so much the mantra that they don't know how to get out of it, and therefore they can't really say anything, and so it's kind of at a dead end. And so I would hope that people in that party could recover the optimism. I mean, really, just think about it. In 1964, white segregationist Southerners were uniformly Democrats, and Republicans were the party of Lincoln. And when Barry Goldwater opposed the Civil Rights Act and Lyndon Johnson signed it, the first Republicans sprang up in the Senate. When I was growing up, we didn't even have any Republicans. We didn't have any. They were as scarce as polar bears in Atlanta. They were eccentrics. But all I'm trying to say is that it is part of the euphemizing of American politics, that it is not a reality or even up for discussion, that only race in our political history has the power to turn the partisan structure of the United States upside down. Starting in 1964, Alabama elected 5 Republican House members in the fall of 1964, none of whom had been Republicans before Barry Goldwater announced it. I mean, they all ran down to the courthouse. So it changed things, and we need to recognize that that is a pitfall, and that to recover our optimism, we've got to transcend it. And as I say, I think it would help to recite the preamble and to say the purpose of our government is to accomplish all these things, and that's what we're here to debate. I don't have much more specific agenda for Hillary. I worry that Hillary, I've known her for a long time. We were roommates in 72, so that's a long time ago. I'm worried that she's under tremendous pressure to prove that she's tough, that she'll bomb people, and because she's a woman. I think that's a big challenge for her.
Thank you for coming to Lexington to speak tonight.
Could you have recited it?
The preamble?
Yeah.
Yes, but I did have to remind myself. I looked it
up. Thank you.
So you're saying that, we're misremembering our past, and you talked about how the civil rights movement kind of led into the women's movement and LGBTQ movement as well, and how we're misremembering that. But I think members of my generation would counter that we've seen a lot of successes in the last couple of years with these movements. So like, for instance, this year we just got legalized same-sex marriage, and there's a pretty powerful Black Lives Matter movement going on now. So can you just kind of respond to that? Like, isn't there a movement still happening today, and how do you?
No. What I'm saying is, first of all these movements are buried under a general cynicism that we haven't really accomplished a lot in politics, that government has been bad. But in fact, the white South has benefited as much as anybody else, as Dr. King said, and it's spread all over the place. I'm just saying that what we don't appreciate is that through the politics of that time and the ripple effects since, the cumulative benefits, if you look at them all together and say, Black people opened the door, that notion of equal citizenship, when you really start struggling with what it means and you reach out and you expose yourself to danger the way Black people did, put themselves in the middle of a whole bunch of white Klansmen, that's the kind of daring in for common purpose that continues to do this. And so we need to recapture the links, you know, that these things are all struggling over what equal citizenship is doing in the name of we the people, and the movements all, I'll tell you, the movements are all together, a consequence of one another. Frankly, LGBT people are more frank and open about acknowledging the fact that the example of the civil rights movement helped them. A lot of the other movements are not, and quite frankly, black leaders are often very resistant to claim credit for the benefits that flowed to other movements, like the women's movement or the disability movement, the senior citizens, because they say to do that would detract from their own agenda, that they've still got tremendous problem. We want to emphasize the race problem and not talk about anything larger. And my point always is the movement succeeded back then because they were always looking at something larger, and they were always looking at how this is not just about black and white, this is about justice, and that justice will flow to everybody, so that when you put things in a larger context, it comes back to help you too. I'm just saying they all came out of a common mindset and a common historical framework and a sense of risk. And what citizenship means, you know, we have more of a consumer sense of politics today, not a citizenship, and that if we could recapture that, it'd be good for everybody. We didn't think of the, you know, like Ivan Allen and modern sports and everything, we didn't think of the, you never heard of the Sun Belt when the South was segregated. The prosperity was part of the liberation that was set in motion by black sharecroppers. And that's a profound thought that's not often recognized. Thank you very much for coming. I don't see any other questions, but I'd be happy to talk to anybody else afterwards.
There's an opportunity after this event, if you're interested in talking to our guest or having a book signed, please come up. Thank you very much. Thank you.